Okay, in this video, I want to talk to you about power in a negotiation in terms of your strategic orientation. Okay, but to do so, it's important to understand the characteristics of power and then how it's used, right? So, and that will affect ultimately your orientation. So, to start with, let's talk about the characteristics of power. Okay, so we know that we associate power with subjecting it to upon someone else, right? Influencing someone else because of through your ability to affect them without their consent, right? Your ability to exert some level of influence on them that they're not consenting to. So again, that's power. You see it generally in a strategic orientation that's more competitive, right? Or negotiation itself that's distributed in nature, where you have a finite or fixed sum resource that you're negotiating over. Okay. Now, the power itself can be used in various ways, right? We know it can be oppressive and abusive. You could push it onto someone, or it can simply be a point of support or a point of a benign influence that you know that somebody has the power, it is there, you respect it, and ultimately that means that you follow it, right? Some see law enforcement, right, in society as being oppressive and abusive. Others see it as benign and supportive, right? The rule of law, saying that I feel comfortable, I feel safe, that if anybody, including me, breaks rules, that those rules will be enforced against me or enforced against that other person, and that makes me believe that other people are going to act in a certain way in society, right? So I can see the power that's exerted by the government through the executive branch, through the, in this case, through police force, as being benign and supportive, right? That way. So power again can take on those dual roles, right? Same way in a negotiation. Okay. And then your approaches to power, right? You can either increase your own power in comparison to someone else, or you can decrease their power in comparison to you. And either one of them has the effect of creating some level of disproportion in the distribution of power in the situation. So one person having more power, more ability to influence the other side, may have some level of advantage over the other side because of that, right? And that being said, which brings us to types of uses of power, right? Potential power is the power that somebody has the ability to exert, right? It can give you confidence in the negotiation, knowing that you can pull this lever, that you can exert this amount of power, right? That type of thing. Likewise, perceived power that the other person perceives that you have, whether that's real, right? Whether you really have that potential power or not, whether they just perceive it. Again, that can be a strong influence upon them in the negotiation. Even the power that they perceive about themselves or recognize that they have, in the same with you, right? So what power you perceive is present and how it can be utilized. And then realized power, that is power that's carried out, okay? Power that's actually demonstrated in a way so that it's known, it's understood, it might have been utilized on the other party so that it has always had or already had an effect on them or already had an effect on the context of the negotiation. So taken together, these are the characteristics of power and how they're potentially used. In another video, we'll talk to you about the various sources of power that you'll find commonly in a negotiation.